this very moment, I wouldn't like to be anywhere else. This is a wonderful occasion when I would never have imagined that one day I would be sitting together with you at a beach. And I'm going to ask you a number of questions. And we all know that since you ran the design agency, Total Design, in Amsterdam, the world has changed a lot.
Completely.
And one day, I have heard you say that if you were a young man now, you would probably be something different, have a different profession from being a graphic designer. Could you say some more about this?
Yeah, I think if I have to start all over again, I will be an architect. It's different from graphic design, but the thing is, when I was in school, in the art school, my art school in Holland, in the north of Holland, in Groningen, it was a fantastic building. It was the first modernist building in Holland, built in 1923, and it was laying in the city like an ocean liner, very concrete and steel structure. And on the top floor of the building was our art school. And I was so impressed by that building that I learned more from the building than from the teachers, I think. I realized myself this much later, not in the time when I was a student, but much later. So it was more or less luck and circumstances that I became a graphic designer and an exhibition designer. But ongoing, I thought I'll be an architect. I would have liked to be an architect. And now you're asking me this question, and I say, well, I'm sure I will be an architect.
Right. What I thought you were referring to is that design, graphic design, is nowadays much more screen-based than paper-based. Everything you did has been printed on paper in the way of graphic design. But designers nowadays are much more oriented towards the screen. Would that have influenced your decisions?
Well, I'm absolutely addicted to the computer, so it's a great wonder that it came over us, because most of my work has been done by hand, a lot of labor. If I had to make a poster, it took me at least 3 days to make the basic thing of a poster. And today, when I do a design, I can do so much more in a short period. So it's absolutely a wonder. But in the same time, I'm not jealous on young designers today, because there are so many possibilities. I think the world was much easier for us. It was you had a much clearer view on what happened. And today it's so complicated. At least I have the impression that it is very complicated today. So I'm not jealous on young designers. On the other hand, I'm very jealous on young designers, since they have so many possibilities. And finding their own way in all these possibilities must be difficult, I think. Yes. And that's what I had in mind by saying this.
All right. Now you refer to the all the different possibilities that are available to young designers nowadays. In the 60s, when you started Total Design with a group of other designers, there was a huge optimism. Everybody was very optimistic. It was some 15 years after the end of the Second World War. The conditions were steadily improving, and it seems that the situation is somewhat different today. What do you think about that?
Well, indeed, in the time when we were, when I was trained in the time, and especially the period after the Second World War, was a very optimistic period. We all had the idea that we were working on a better world, and more or less automatically you were in the stream of the things that were happening. That is another difficulty today, I think, because I am not of the opinion that young designers today are optimistic in what happens with the world, and that is quite depressing, I think. I don't know whether this is an answer to your question, but
in part, hand in hand with the optimism went the acceptation of a single style by many designers. That's another thing that is absent today, and I don't know for sure whether the two hang completely together, but what you see nowadays is that everybody tries to develop a personal style and personal views. Yeah. And wouldn't the world be better off with a bit more sort of graphic solidarity?
Well, I absolutely think so. But what can you do? I mean, you can change the world in a day.
Well, in 1965, you thought the world could be changed.
That's what we thought, and that was the sound of modernism. Modernism has a very optimistic view on the world, and we were looking for unity and a kind of direction. All designers went in the same direction. They were working together and trying to find a solution for the problems that there were daily. But today it's absolutely shattered, and it's everyone wants to, as you explain, make it personal and think. I don't know what to think of. The only thing I think is good design has always been good design. And even today, you see a lot of very good design.
That's true.
And I have the impression that in percentages of what is, of the bulk of what is created, that it's still the same as it was in that time. No matter what the idea behind it is, the amount of good design between the whole bulk of design that's done is still the same here today. So I'm very optimistic, still, in spite of that it goes in all directions. And I wouldn't have another solution. I wouldn't know. So as I said before, I'm jealous on the young designers today, but at the same time, I'm not so jealous on young designers today.
Because of the difficulties they are facing.
The difficulty of what direction you should go and find your own way is, I think, much more difficult than in my time, yes.
Yeah. Probably we had in the 60s a lot of problems too, but we didn't see them. And
we didn't want to see them.
Maybe. Well, there was the Cold War, for example, which doesn't exist anymore. So to stick with this subject for a few minutes longer, one of your favorite typefaces has always been Universe.
Yeah.
Designed by Adrian Frutiger, one of the famous designers interviewed by Donald and his compatriots and in the CD box. One of the popular approaches of typography in the 60s was one or two typefaces is more than enough, we don't need any more.
Yeah.
And an American designer, Massimo Vignelli, not so long ago, was still saying this in a lecture he gave on a conference, and at least one person present here in the audience, Yves Peters, wanted to strangle him. And what you see at the moment is completely the opposite. You see a proliferation of type design going in many different directions. There too, there is no sort of binding element. It's absolutely everyone for himself, it seems.
And you want me to react on that?
Yes.
Well, I agree completely with Massimo Vignelli. I think we could do with two types, it's enough. But at the same time, I understand quite well that people want to express themselves and find all the ways to do this personal expression. But I remember a client of mine. I was working for the book publisher Harry and Abrams in New York, and I had to do a book on Rembrandt. It was in the middle of the 60s. And I proposed to do this book in the universe. And then the publisher said, this is impossible. You cannot do a book on Rembrandt in the universe. It should be a typeface that expresses the work of Rembrandt. I said, but it's a book that is published now on Rembrandt, who lived ages before. So this is a crazy statement to do a book. And because if we want to do every subject with a specific typeface that fits the subject, we don't have typefaces enough. It's surely not in the 60s.
Oh, nowadays we have.
Nowadays we have for every subject a typeface, but I honestly must say I lost the battle, because he said we are not going to publish the book with the universe, and I used the Bembo. That's my second type. Always when I am not allowed to use a sans serif typeface, I use the Bembo, because I like the Bembo very much as a typeface. So I still have the impression that we can do with lossless typefaces.
Well, in fact, many
you want to express this time, isn't it?
Yes.
And that's it.
Yep. Wim, it was a great pleasure to see all your work together on Tuesday evening in the Stedelijk Museum. And as I already have let you know then, there are a few favorites I have within your body of work. But despite the discipline and the severity of your approach to graphic design, two things have always deeply touched me in your work, and that is, first of all, your sense of color, and secondly, your sense of space. The last thing, obviously, has to do with your wish to be an architect.
Yes.
But you have a very specific sense of color, and it's beautiful. But color is a thing which is very emotional in principle, and far removed from the discipline of a typographic grid.
Absolutely.
And having only one or two typefaces. Could you say a bit more about your use of color?
You have very difficult questions. I have often said that I have always, during my whole career, fought a battle between aesthetics and rationality. I'm greatly in favor of very rational design, very functional design, very straightforward design without questions, and in the same time I want to do nice things. So the aesthetics play a very important role. And in color, I may have also a one-track mind in color. Because if you analyze my use of color, it's mainly cool colors. It's only every now and then that I use, for instance, a red color.
Yes.
But most of my posters are in gray, bluish, cool colors. And I think that is also part of the expression of trying to find, even within the whole jungle of color, a certain direction. But it's a very expressionist thing.
These cool colors you talk about are basically very Dutch colors. When you compare the colors you see around you here in the Netherlands with what you see, for example, in Rome, in Italy, Mediterranean climate gives you completely different colors, very deep blue.
Maybe I'm influenced by that lousy weather we always have.
Probably, yes.
It's quite
you're very Dutch.
Quite
you're a very Dutch designer.
I am a Dutch designer, yeah.